J Ray 501 here. I'm listening again to the Project Camla Dutch Synths Part 2, and there was something in here that kind of caught my attention. And I'm not bringing this up to bash anyone, to discredit anyone, or embarrass anyone. I'm doing this to clarify a mistake. That's all. If we stop hating on each other and start helping each other, we can all learn instead of being divided. You know, this is exactly what they, in parentheses, this is exactly what they want from us, is to have civil unrest. Because if we're not working together, guess what? They can pick us off pretty quick. So, without further ado, let me show you what mistake that I found.
And what I've come to find out about Fukushima is extremely disturbing. And I've seen all of Benjamin Fulford's videos. I've seen them all. I've seen all the videos on HARP and just everything. I've put in a month's worth of study on this, at least, straight on the Fukushima aspect. And what I've come to find out is that the radiation that's been released from Fukushima, and there was radiation released from Fukushima, is that eventually you're not going to believe what it's going to decay into. When radioactive decay happens, these radioactive elements, especially xenon and cesium, they will actually, and iodine, they break down into strotium and barium.
Strotium. What the heck is strotium?
Over the course of time. Now, does that sound familiar to anybody? Strotium and barium are the prime ingredients that we all know are listed in chemtrails. So what Fukushima was a long-term release of a large amount of strotium and barium in the long term. That's what it's going to turn into. So when I found that out, I couldn't believe it. I just said, oh my God, I learned this back in high school or college, and now it's all coming back. And I went and looked up strotium and barium, and it turns out the United States Army Science Labs, so they have their own laboratories, developed a device that's capable of, here it is in the chat right there, that developed a device that's capable of projecting a beam into the atmosphere over a large distance, but its primary component that requires it to work is barium and strotium.
That's awesome.
Okay. And Carrie says, oh, that's awesome. Okay. 1 month of research on the deal with Fukushima. He spent a lot of time researching. And yet, he just said strotium instead of strontium 4 times. Okay. That's number one mistake. Then he said that the radioactive isotopes are turning into strotium and barium. And that's not true. Xenon turns into barium-136. Cesium, with a half-life of 30 years, turns into barium-137. Iodine-131, with a half-life of 8 days, turns into xenon-131. Who turns into strotium? So I looked up strotium and barium. And guess what I came up with? A Dutch Synths video saying exactly what he just stated in the interview. Nuclear material will decay into chemtrails. Yes, that's true. Barium and strontium. He's got it right here. But But then he says again, these radioactive elements will decay into barium and strontium. Okay, so I played this video again. Maybe I'm missing something. Maybe I'm confused about what I thought I knew about strontium. And so he...
Dutch sense here.
Does...
It is 2:26 a.m. Central Standard Time on Tuesday. Nuclear transmutation.
Okay, nuclear
transmutation. And I learned about this in school, of course, and if you just file it in the back of your head, it's just one of those terms you hear. And this is just amazing. Cesium-137, which is one of the radioactive isotopes being released from the Japanese nuclear reactor, when it's exposed to the environment, okay, after it's out,
it turns
it decays
into barium.
A non-radioactive form of barium.
Okay.
Okay. Alright, so cesium-137 turns into barium. Well, being the inquisitive person that I am, I went and looked it up. And not only does it turn into barium, but look. It turns into strontium too.
Okay, he's in
these
reasoning
elements are turning
behind
into barium
transmutation.
And strontium.
Okay, reasoning behind. This is the same page he just read. Reasoning behind transmutation. Isotopes of plutonium and other actinides tend to be long-lived with half-lives of many thousand years, whereas radioactive fission products tend to be shorter-lived, most with half-lives of 30 years or less. It is important to understand that the threat posed by a radioisotope is influenced by many factors, including the chemical and biological properties of the element. For instance, cesium has a relatively short biological half-life, 1 to 4 months, while strontium and radium both have very long biological half-lives. As a result, strontium-90 and radium are much more able to cause harm than cesium-137 when a given activity is ingested. I still haven't read where he just said that this transmutation is transmuting into strontium. Many of the actinides are very radiotoxic because they have long biological half-lives and are alpha emitters. In transmutation, the intention is to convert the actinides into fission products. The fission products are very radioactive, but the majority of the activity will decay away within a short time. The most worrying short-lived fission products are those that accumulate in the body, such as iodine-131, which accumulates in the thyroid. But it is hoped that by a good design of the nuclear fuel transmutation plant, that such fission products can be isolated from humans and their environment and allowed to decay. In the medium term, the fission products of the highest concern are strontium-90 and cesium-137. Both have a half-life of about 30 years. Cesium-137 is responsible for the majority of the external gamma dose experienced by workers in nuclear processing plants. Okay, he was pointing to this particular, I've read this page 4 or 5 times, and I have yet to find where he was saying that anything transmutes into strontium. Okay? Again, I'm sure that this is just an error because he remembers all of this from school. And it's probably been a while since he was in school. Right? So, let's look up strontium. It is an alkaline earth metal, and it is a yellowish metallic element that is highly reactive chemically. It occurs naturally in minerals, celestine and strontianite. with, while natural strontium is stable, the synthetic strontium isotope is present in radioactive fallout and has a half-life of about 28.90 years. K isotopes. Strontium is a byproduct of the fission of uranium and plutonium. Again, I'm not seeing it's short-lived artificial radioisotope that is used in the treatment of bone cancer, but when you're ingesting it, it can actually cause bone cancer. Now, I did not see anything in here about what it turns into. Depends on what it's mixed with, because this is actually seems like it's slightly unstable if it's mixed with water. I mean, it's got some interesting products. Okay, so I didn't see anything in here. Okay. So this is one of the other pages, cesium. Properties. What is exposure? By now everybody knows. Non-radioactive cesium occurs naturally in various minerals. Radioactive cesium-137 is produced when uranium and plutonium absorb neutrons and undergo fission. Okay. So, I'm really not trying to diss anybody, but this is not what I would expect from Dutch. You know, once you start to really make a name for yourself, you know, that's why a lot of these people that do get really busy and have a lot of information they want to put out, they have researchers. They have people helping them. And that's for a reason. Because it's easy to kind of, you know, make a mistake. So, again, I'm sure I've made plenty of mistakes too. So, I'm really not trying to be some bandwagon monster here. But yeah, just makes me want to be a little bit more cautious, for sure. And then also on this video, the Camelot video, this is an important interview by Carrie Cassidy of Project Camelot with Dutch Sense, and has instructions to copy and make this interview viral, which is what I am helping to do. Now, I don't understand this. Remember, bad people achieve their aims by good people standing idly by and doing nothing. There you have it.